welcome. Thank you all for coming to join us. My name is Bridget Bray. I'm the Director of Exhibitions at Asia Society Texas Center. And it's a pleasure to see so many familiar faces in the audience, some of you from this morning's members brunch, which is excellent. Before we get started, I'd like to recognize the donors that support both the programs and the exhibitions that we present here at the center. Lead exhibition support is provided by the City of Houston through the Houston Arts Alliance, Nancy C. Allen, the Clayton Fund, Ann and Albert Chow, Dorothy Carsey Sumner, Eagle Global Advisors, and the Vivian L. Smith Foundation. We have also enjoyed additional funding from Jerry Ann Cheney, Vani Rao, and Tulasidas Kalidas, India House Houston, and Marilyn Oshman. We're also pleased to have the support of a special group called the Friends of Exhibition, and also all of our members here at the center who are very important to the work that we do. In addition, I'd like to recognize our partner for today's program, the Hindu American Foundation. And we're very pleased to have them in partnership today because they've recently recognized Manjari for their Dharmic Arts Award for 2014. So that's very special for her and for all of us to be working together. I would ask you to silence your cell phones at this point in the program. And also to mark your calendars for September 14th, which is not only the last day of the exhibition of Transcendent Deities where Manjari's work is featured, but also a program at 2 p.m. that Sunday will include Abhishek Singh, who is another artist included in the exhibition, and it will be in a conversation format. He'll be in conversation with Julie Romain, who is a curator at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, who was an early champion of his work. So as you all know so well, Asia Society is really in the business of bringing art and people into conversation. And it's a unique opportunity for us when we can also bring the artist into the conversation so you can talk with them directly, which is something that we really enjoy doing here. Manjari will do her presentation and then it'll be followed by Q&A after, so you will have a chance to speak with her. Just a little bit about our topic for the presentation of her work. Associated with Hindu worship, darshan is a Sanskrit word meaning vision or view, and refers to the experience of connection between deity and viewer. Historically, Hindu deities have been depicted predominantly through sculpture and painting, rather than her chosen mode of photography. Multiple trips to Mumbai and collaborations with a sizable team of local artisans, sculptors, and painters resulted in lavish sets, ornate costumes, and models styled to render each of the 9 elaborately staged archetypal representations, which she will take you through during this afternoon's presentation. So please help me in welcoming Manjari to Asia Society.
Thank you all for coming out, and thank you so much, Bridget, for such a lavish introduction. And I'm just so pleased to be in the company of artists that I admire, specifically Raja Ravi Varma, who I studied for a very long time. And also it's really beautiful to see the space finally. I had received the installation shots earlier. And I finally got to see the exhibit after the brunch, and I feel like I'm so glad I did it before the talk, because I was telling Bridget, it's a whole different experience to see your work in the scale that it's been represented. And just makes it easier for you to plan something now with the viewing distance and the ceiling, the limitless ceiling that Asia Society has. The space is beautiful. So I'm going to go through my process of this project, and I'm going to start with the meaning of the word darshan. And so darshan is a Sanskrit word, and it has roots in Hindu worship. So like Bridget said, it's called sight or vision or auspicious vision. And the root is the word daras, which means sight, which means to see. And it also could be compared to an apparition or a glimpse. So this is, for example, what you would see outside a Hindu temple. It would be a little sign that will say, darshan timing, X times in the morning. This temple seems to be unique, has a lot of darshan timings. It perhaps is a temple that houses many other mini temples in it. So you would go in for this darshan. So, for example, usually you would see a priest inside this little area worshiping the deity. You will not see the deity. Often you've got lines outside the temple spaces. And you know, often you just see a sea of heads in front of you, and you can hear the invocations and the bells going. And then at some point, of course, the door opens, and then you get to see, you know, this visual representation of the deity that you're here to worship. So, but you know, traditionally, there's a preferred methodology of how this is done. There, it's almost always a molded figure. Or sometimes it's a painting or an illustration that's based on the descriptions of avatars in Hindu scripture. But of course, looking here is the key. So, you know, to when you look, you're hoping that something looks back at you. And, you know, so your eye kind of meets with the eye of what's before you and kind of completes this circle of credibility. So it's not always that the look back happens, I think, and that's why some darshans are special, and you know, and they burn a hole in your memory. So, you know, to look is an act of choice, and see, I feel like that is a very important part, because your consciousness is being summoned in this space, and it's often a combination, or it's a multisensory experience. There's, you can hear, you can see, you can smell. There's often, it's crowded, you know, so a darshan conjures up many, many different senses. So, you know, I have here a few of my, you know, just snapshots from over the years of different temple renderings and, you know, various media that have impacted my own project. And, you know, this ranges from little local temples to, you know, grandeur pilgrimage that you would take, small little ones that you find in caves where you don't expect to find deities. So let's just think for a second about the idea of sculpture, right? And to think of an idea of sculpture, you kind of have to go back to the very first form of sculpture, which, you know, is the idea of a stone. And I think, you know, something is really special about a stone. A stone likely came before you and is probably going to outlive you. So maybe there is something in our psyche that feels that we are eternal, and the stone takes on that aspect. So, you know, which is probably why we end up using them as grave markers. But also, you know, to touch is to know that something is real. So the idea of sculpture is very important. And as it, I mean, and for me to understand this idea of sculpture was very important, because what I was about to embark upon used a lot of sculptural elements, even if the final presentation was two-dimensional, the sculpture was very important. So, you know, I remember actually reading about the importance of stone, because before I was about to enter into taking these three-dimensional memories and putting them into flat two-dimensional representations, I needed to study the idea of 3D a little more. I also think it's amazing that almost always the physical has this connection to the metaphysical, that just, it may not be apparent at the time, but that connection does have to be studied over time. So I'm just going to go through some fantastical sculptural elements that, you know, at Mahabalipuram in South India, that really impacted me a lot when I was a child. And just the idea that even now, if you go to a temple in India, and there is probably some wear or tear that needs to be worked on, I love that you can still see the craftsman sort of sitting and tinkering and chipping away on, you know, this little piece that has to be repaired. And so, you know, definitely, and also it's so great that sculpture weathers and changes and ages with time. So growing up, road tripping was very important in my house. And my father loved to open up the map and say, okay, it's going to take us 15 days to get somewhere. And, you know, we'll stop off along the way. And that's when my mom would say, okay, well, then we need to hit this temple and then this one and this one along the way. And that's what we're going to do. And so I remember sometimes our responses ranged from, oh, cool, to not another temple, mom, please. And so the experiences always range from being surprised, you know, to like pleasantly surprised to how interesting this temple was, to being overwhelmed sometimes with, you know, the crowds and the noise. And, you know, again, the renderings were all so different. So even if you went to a temple 100 miles away, you just entered into a different state, and the same representation of Vishnu was now completely different. So this is our little temple at home, and that's my dad, and he doesn't know that he's in the presentation today. And so that's a little temple around the corner from our home where the elephant visits every Saturday, and it was really fun to go to more for the elephant than for the temple. And so this is a temple on wheels, and you know, of course, this is Haridwar, which is one of the four top pilgrimages that you could go to in India. It's really interesting, the story. I remember my mom telling me it's very difficult to go to all four together. There's four Rishikesh and Haridwar and Badrinath and Kedarnath, and these four, when you go to do it, you can't something's gonna go wrong. Not everyone is destined to do all four. Everyone sets out to do all four, but you don't always complete the four. And sure enough, we couldn't. We set out to do four, and we could only do two because there was a big cascade. A mountain fell down and blocked the road, and we couldn't go any further. And straight out of a movie, definitely happened. My parents have since finished there. They can check it off. And I obviously moved to Brooklyn and couldn't do it anymore. So this is Badrinath, and this is a decadent and beautiful temple that, you know, it starts, the worship ceremonies here start at 4 o'clock in the morning. This is Rameshwaram. So this is a drive-by shot. I remember us driving by, and I'm just saying, Mom, look at the scale of that. You know, and I specifically pulled out these shots from really researching many, many different little things that impacted me along the way. This is the first time I saw a Ramayana poster. The word on the left is the word Ramayan. And so this was the first memorable soap in India, a mythological soap. And I remember when it used to go on that you could hear it like simultaneously from like 25 television sets. Everyone was watching it. And the director for this was Ramanand Sagar, and his grandson helped me with props for my project. So, and I find that, and it's amazing how I ran into him. I definitely didn't look for him. I was looking, well, I'll come to that story later. So, and then this is the sculptor. He's on the phone, and he's obviously busy, but during Ganesha festival, you see these renderings of Ganesha everywhere. This is Rama. It's a very famous temple, ISKCON, in Haridwar. Actually, it's in Rishikesh. And so my purpose for this first part of the presentation is to kind of build this range of structural influence. And this is a very modern temple. These, you know, the all marble statues are a very new thing. You actually have like more minimal jewelry on the gods and goddesses now in some of the newer temples. And these illustrations are in Madurai. So sculpture is 3D and painting is 2D. And of course, motion is frames in animation. But memory, of course, is multidimensional. You can't really assign dimension to memory. So for me to work from all of this material and you know, use it to create this photograph was a very interesting job, because even though I had, you know, I have tons and tons of source material, what I was going after was somewhere in between all of these, and all of with strong influences from all of these other mediums. So I think the key word here is experience, because like when I talk about a darshan is not just visual, right? So for me, it was, you know, so experience is linked by associated pattern. And so we take all of the sensory information somehow, and we, you know, put it back in our archives until it's time for some retrieval. And you know, you don't always choose that retrieval. So I'm going to define darshan once again. It's a Sanskrit word that means vision, and it's used in the context of Hindu worship. A darshan is an experience that's purposed on helping one call out to his or her sense of spirituality. So this means the hope is that you, when you go in for a darshan, that you have a spiritual awakening. So I love this part because I definitely got really, when I was planning this lecture, and I love how you have to take all of these like dots and form a pattern out of how you might have arrived onto this project. But so in Freudian psychology, the unconscious, in Freudian psychology, memory is called the unconscious mind. So the unconscious mind is where your first kiss lives. This is where your ideas of connection and joy live. And this is where your rituals of birth and death live. And you don't always think about them, but this is where they live. And so when we repeat these things, when we hold hands again, when we kiss again, or when we do these very specific customs that are handed down to us, we seek to relive this idea of mythology. And so myths can bring us spiritual consciousness. They don't always, but they can. But they're also clues into our spiritual potential. And they're multi-generational. But that doesn't mean that you just take what's given from your previous generation. I think we all really love taking that material and personalizing it, and you know, so we can feel like we're a part of an unfolding in some way. So I feel like, you know, this idea of the scent, what I smelled when I was in these places, and, you know, the light, because, you know, temples are placed in very specific, from a Vastu perspective, they are placed in the east in a specific way so the light can dance in the architecture in a very particular way. And I remember telling Bridget, I want the room to be really dark and I want the pictures to be lit in a very specific way. And it's so exciting to see how it was done. And the sound is very important. And the mood is important, and these long hallways are important. So with all of this, it brings me kind of to my, you know, who I am really at a personal level. I'm a portraitist, and so the face and the expression is really important for me. You know, the likeness and the mood of a character is important to me. And I love that in portraiture, if a person is looking at the photographer, then he is also looking at the viewer. So it goes through me to you. And so these are some of my early influences. I love Satyajit Ray. He is a filmmaker. And this is an early Raja Ravi Varma painting. She is a very contemporary artist, Nusha Tavakolian. And of course, Herbert Poynting. So these are just some, you know, these people were peppered through my last decade of just people I studied. So I think this is, I just remember the first Google Earth image of the US. It was such an important point when that came up, when Google Earth became important. So I moved to the US 10 days before 9/11. It was a pretty jarring time to move to the US. But I feel like a lot of my work after moving to the US started to somehow address the disparity between these two cultures, the culture that I came from and the new culture that I was forming. So this is an interesting thing that I think happens to a lot of us. So I'm going to use the idea of the stone again. And this is something that's called participation mystique. I think that is such a beautiful way to describe it. So you get a stone, right? Maybe your grandmother hands you down the stone and she says, this is a really important stone, hold on to it. I value the stone. And so you take it and you know it's important to your grandma, but at some point your objective consciousness kicks in and you say, all right, well, but this is just, it's just a stone. I don't have to overthink this. But then at the point at which it becomes symbolic consciousness for you is when you say, I know this is a stone, I can see it as a stone, but this stone brings me meaning and it brings me history. And I feel like at that point, that is called participation mystique, where you basically take everything that's given to you that you didn't really know what to do with or that you didn't really understand the value for. And then at some point, you know, holding on to it gives you meaning. So I feel like those origins ultimately compelled me to make darshan. So I love this because this is from a very, the quote is from Diane Arbus, who's a legendary photographer, but this is from her Guggenheim application. So I remember when I was just researching papers and I came across this. And I absolutely love this quote because she says, "I want to photograph the considerable ceremonies of our present because we tend to, while living here and now, perceive only what is random, barren, and formless. I want simply to save them because what is curious and commonplace today will one day be legendary." And I just think that that's so poignantly put because these things that just surrounded me always have now become so important. And I think the distance is really important, the distance from them and to not have them in my life every day made a big difference. So when I arrived on this project, I thought to myself, I've seen them as sculptures, I've seen them as paintings, but can I actually invite the viewer to consider the photograph as a means of spiritual engagement? And that is the point at which Darshan was born. So I remember trying out the project in the beginning, and it was just with existing props that I rented, and it was such a bad effort, and it just did not look right. So I planned for sure that I was going to make 9, and I want to say that there's a really important significance of 9 in Hinduism. The rosary has 108 beads. God stands for generator, operator, destroyer. The multiples of 3 are very important. So I just, I liked that it was 9, and I wanted it to be 9, and that's how I started. But I started with what they call the Trimurti, Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh. And I thought about their consorts, and then I thought about how I wanted not just all pleasant women, I wanted to show one really angry woman. And so Akali, I felt like completed that. And then I also thought there was a very important place for the god of all devotees, not just the demigods. And that's how I think Hanuman became important, because he's the most devoted disciple. So this is a very early illustration that I had of how I was thinking this project will come together. And I had just these color blocks of, of how these color chips of how I see all 9 as just these really bold colors. And that's how the beginning, that was all I had in the beginning. Little did I know how it was a lot easier on Illustrator than starting, with the crews. So here's, now, I think from here on, I just have a lot of behind the scenes of all of these pieces. So I remember having to, alter this because the person who actually sat in it had a much bigger fold when she sat down. So Ma Lakshmi, when she, sits in the lotus pose, inside the lotus, her she's much taller. So we had to alter the lotus so it could actually perfectly fit her. Otherwise, it felt it didn't fit. And we had to alter the elephants, as you can tell, to be much taller. This is the art director. We planned the props and which lotus worked. Here is a behind the scenes moment from the set, and I was doing it on a rooftop, and it was a really windy day, which I learned was not very helpful for productivity. So we had a lot of flying foam core pieces. It was very funny. I have no video. So also, it became really interesting how important prosthetics. When I made Lakshmi, which was in January of 2011, I didn't have any prosthetics needed at the point because 4 hands are easy. I could have someone hiding behind her for the 2 extra hands. But prosthetics became very important, and that department itself was held down by this incredible artist called Anil Pemgirikar, and he had a team of 11 that helped me with everything from hair on the body to, multiple arms to making of the crowns. So, he would take the plaster off. But finding the person first was the most important part. You found the person because without the person, you couldn't have a fitting crown or matching hands. So, once I found my Kali, so this is, for example, the measuring of the head and the plaster for the hand, and she was like, I remember her saying, "This is great. I'm getting all my emails done." She's like, "I haven't been able to get all the work done, but this is perfect." She released, and so, you know, then molds would come out, and that is what they would actually make the extra hands from. And this is, you know, an image of the final hands coming together before they're painted, which the painting would again happen, you know, true to the color of the actual deity. Well, this one was easy because she's blue, so everything had to be blue, so it was perfect. This is the crown coming together. I have some more images actually of like the sketches of the crown before the crown was formed. This is the first mold of the crown before we actually started to build gems on it. The painting crew. And so the Kali image, which is, you know, disconnected and it comes in later, we wanted to paint this entire war scene behind her, which you can see on the bottom, just showing a big army of troops. But then we wanted it to appear as if those troops were coming off the background onto the set. And so that is when we started to sculpt little people with arms coming off of the page, which you will see later in the images. That's Ma Kali. That's her set as it started to come together. And that's the incredible fishing line people. And they were doing such a critical job because they were on either ends, and there'd be times when but there was no way for them to know when the shutter was stripped. So, you know, she'd be like, okay, we're done, put it down. Because they were just holding a combination of her hair and the created hair behind. These are some of the Polaroid peel-offs that were being studied. This is Ma Saraswati's set coming together. We ended up scrapping this because the shape was a little too banana-like, and we wanted to go back to like more circular shapes for the leaves. So here's an example of the renderings of the crown before they would actually get constructed. And, you know, a lot of experiments would come along the way. So I remember when we were working with Saraswati, and this was the first rendering of Saraswati which did not work out because her crown, it looked like her crown was like a helmet. It felt like it was too heavy, and she was working too hard on balancing the crown because the weight was too much on her head. And so, of course, it doesn't matter if you have a perfect sari, perfect jewelry, perfect everything, and then Saraswati herself cannot relax, you know. So the props have to make the character comfortable, and this crown just wasn't doing it. So the crown was completely reimagined, and we learned that the crowns from the fiber don't work as well as the crowns from copper. So we switched to that crown, which I think works much better. Everything had to be, you know, all the jewelry, it was hard to find jewelry from a different time period, unless you went to a different part of India to go and buy the real jewelry, which was a little out of my budget. And so we decided to construct, you know, take pieces of modern jewelry and then connect them with other pieces found from people's homes. So the, you know, what she's wearing on her arm is actually not really used. It's a necklace. It's a neck piece. And then, you know, the jewelry creator would combine different pieces. But then once you would do it, then you would need to do two more for the person behind. So it was, it's definitely challenging to get the jewelry right. That's the spray painting of Vishnu, his snake coming together. It was, the first time they carved it out of a block, they realized it was too small. Those were always the really hard parts, to go to the craftsman and say, this has to be done again. And, you know, they didn't like me very much when that happened. But I think they forgave me in the end. He did not want his picture taken, but it was very important for size. And so that's the layers of Lord Vishnu's set coming together. And then all the little planets that you see that are hung with fishing line. So that is Lord Brahma, and he is Lord Brahma is the creator of the universe and also an architect by his day job, which I think is very fitting. And a lot of this happened. So I felt like my Saraswati was an anchor on NBC, on CNBC in India. And I feel like I ended up finding people who somehow their day jobs, or there was some reflection of the actual character in their life itself, which was definitely serendipitous. And that, I think it's amazing that I found someone with that beard. Okay, that was, because I could have, working with a fake beard just wasn't cutting it. And just the fact that it belonged to his face was just such a bonus. And so that's the making of Brahma set with the clouds, with just all the cotton that came together and the spray painting of the cotton. It was actually a very, I was laughing about this earlier, it was a very cloudy day to begin with, but those clouds, they were useless to me. Lord Brahma's makeup. And so Lord Hanuman was also, so Lord Hanuman is particularly, all of his stories are about his strength and valor. And it's amazing that Lord Hanuman is actually, he's a national bodybuilder. He's a champion. He thought it was incredible for him to play this part because he definitely seeked Hanuman's blessing every morning for what he did. So that was, again, very perfectly matched. That is his bodysuit, in which every piece of hair that you see on there was actually sewed on. And I'm going to be showing like two little time-lapse videos at the end of this that show the making of Hanuman's costume. I love my cloud prop holders. It was really great to, this question was asked earlier this morning by Bridget about why this project was done in India, and you know, it could have been done in the US as well. But so, for example, the guy in the purple over there, the guy who is holding my lights, he told me at one point that I should watch out for how much ankle my goddess is showing. That is too much ankle on a goddess. He's never seen this much ankle on Ma Durga. And, you know, that was not his job. And he's like, I know this is not my job, but, you know, I've seen a lot of renderings of Durga. Durga is very important in my house. And the way that she's sitting right now, there's just too much ankle on her. And I was, you know, and he was so serious about it. I was like, I'll fix it. I'll take care of it. And we pulled that sari down just a little bit, and he was so right. He was absolutely right. It was such a little detail that was making a difference. And it, you know, even for the tailors, when they made the blouses for the saris, because these are goddesses and they wear very different, you don't see the normal neck that you see on a woman anymore. So they just had to keep taking the blouses up higher and higher because they were just not accustomed to making sari blouses that way anymore. That's from the set of Shiva. The making of his Rakshasa. That's the plaster on Hanuman's face. This is actually the priest that married me and my husband, who played Lord Ganesha. And I always say it was a very uncomfortable conversation when I was trying to tell him how perfect his body was for the job. This is his hands coming together. The woodworkers were especially fascinating, even for me, to just see how, you know, woodwork is very, to find good carpenters in India is actually exceptionally easy because there's just so many, and they don't think of it as art, you know, this is what got handed down to them from their fathers, and they're just craftsmen, but they're just so good at it. Forming of the props with foam core, which became the most important material in my life for 3 years straight. Foam core, I did everything with foam core. Foam core is an amazing thing. This is the fitting, mask fitting for Ganesha's face. And there's just so many little moments that I remember as I go through this, that, you know, especially when he had to be in that mask for a very long time, and then we were trying to give him juice from under his little trunk so he can stay hydrated. And it takes a lot from the, and most of the people, most of the characters who were like, this is great, I'm definitely, I don't have any problem, I'm happy to do the part, were at the end of it just realized how absolutely physical the process was for them as well. It was just so sad when that arch had to be split, because it was just, you know, they made the most perfect arch, and then they just made it a little too big, and we had to slice it down the center so we could bring it closer, because it just wasn't enough time to build another arch. And before, though, of course, before the arch was split into two, I had all of these like plans for the arch, you know, where I would be using it in my home, of course. And very sad to see it get split. And so I definitely made the arch that hadn't been split, I put it as a part of the video just so I can keep it for my memory. So this is Lord Ganesha, the final of Lord Ganesha, remover of obstacles. And I love that he is holding laddus. Laddus are the little like sweet treats. It's what he has in his hands. Lord Ganesha loved to eat, therefore the body. And his many of his stories have to do with him, just being so hungry, and he just had to eat. And so these laddus, which has become really important during his laddus and modaks that become very important during the Ganesha festival. I tried to do it. The real ones are about the same size, and I tried to do the image with real ones, but the real laddus would make the picture look fake, because everything else was fake. And everything else was made of foam core, so a real laddu was just throwing it out of balance. So I had to get my whole plan of using real laddus, and then at the last minute I had to make the craftsman make fake foam core laddus for me and spray paint them, because the real laddus wouldn't work. So that's like, those were the things, big things of education for me, to how to just work with the materials and how, what kind of a world the materials create. Ma Lakshmi, goddess of wealth and fortune. So here's another example about just where photography, you know, to learn the limitations of photography, where in illustration or in painting, you can really choose your vanishing points. So if you notice the way she's sitting, her body kind of doesn't really look natural, I think. Like she's got her torso looks really, really long. And that's because the whole lotus itself is tilted, which would actually make her bend forward, but she compensates for it by sitting up straight. And that gives her this like really unnaturally long body posture, which would be, you know, I'm not saying it's easy to make a painting, but I'm saying you can control your vanishing point. So she had to compensate a lot for this, for striking that pose. And she worked very hard on it. Ma Durga. She's the one who had.
A little bit too much ankle. Oh, I have a pointer.
This thing right here. Mm-hmm. This is what we had to pull down. Mm-hmm. You would think that wouldn't make a difference, but imagine being able to see her heel. And you just don't see a goddess's heel in the renderings of Ma Durga. And that was a very real point. It was, you know, I was like, he's playing stump the speaker. I can't say anything. And this was Lord Hanuman. He's the son of wind. Lord Brahma, creator of the universe. Lord Vishnu, the manager, upper management. Lord Shiva, he's the god of dance and destruction. Ma Kali. You can actually probably see the little figures over here that we showed kind of coming off this war scene. Ma Saraswati, goddess of art, music, and education. So this is just an installation shot of where it was first shown, which was it debuted at Clamp Art in New York City. And the space was a little bit smaller than Asia Society. Much, much, much smaller. And I think it just really is such a fitting display here in this space. A little bit of my information. And I'm just going to, before I show you the videos, I'm just going to close with this quote from the Gita that I really love. It is better to live your own destiny imperfectly than to live an imitation of somebody else's life with perfection. I'm going to switch to the video here. Thank you so much. Yeah.
So we thought we would do a little bit of question and answer. So who would like to be first? Wonderful.
I really enjoyed your presentation. I wanted to ask a question, which is, did you at any point consider being one of the figures, being one of the figures yourself? And can you just talk a little bit about why, yes or no? Because it seems like it was an interesting choice not to be.
Yeah. Oh, wow. No, I definitely did not consider using myself, because I kind of didn't imagine if I was in one of the... No. But I do think that that's... I think, though, it is... it's what I'm trying to do, is really humanize both ends of it, you know, because you usually have an inanimate object looking back at you, and not that... this is not about a war between sculpture and photography, but... I do think, for me, the meaning of darshan has changed from the Hindu context that it has. Not changed, but really grown, because to me, I feel like I could have a darshan on the summit of a mountain. I could have a darshan. I had a darshan when I met my husband. You know, I feel like a darshan is a look back that can change you forever, or changes and alters you forever. So in that sense, I feel like that context of Hindu worship to me extended, or just I was able to step away from it and just kind of, you know, study this idea of darshan from a distance, from being here in the US and having my new darshans, which were, you know, going to these art galleries and museums and studios where now art was placed on a pedestal to honor. So the relationship, I mean, the acts were similar, but some things had changed. And so I was definitely, I have never imagined the project with me in it. But you can do one.
Yes.
I haven't spent much time talking to people about these photographs. Mm-hmm. And so your presentation today totally altered my sense of how these were made. I thought these were all created in your workshop using computers. These were all digitally created.
Yeah.
The fact that these probably could have been digitally created means that you made a very deliberate choice not to do that.
Yeah.
And in a sense, you made the same choice that people who are now using 19th century processes.
Mm-hmm.
Would you say something about why you chose to be so hands-on with this?
Yeah, definitely. I'm not a Photoshop artist. I think there are people who, you know, that's their medium, and that's a different medium than photography. I thought constructing this and creating it from scratch was really powerful for me, because it was a real test of your vision, and then that translation into its final, looking at the final product from like looking at it up here, or like planning from color chips. I think I love the performance aspect of it. You know, I thought it was really great to kind of have the energy of this entire group working towards, you know, they had some sense of what I wanted, but the sense of what I wanted also was changing as things were getting constructed. And then I loved the role play, which they, you know, just imagine all of this and then compare this to just like me sitting in front of a screen. So I'm sure I wouldn't have any material to give you other than the fact that I really know how to use Photoshop well, which, I mean, and the people who do that, I'm not taking anything away from that. But I also love that, I love the how much the energy of these other people with me added to that image. And I also love the energy of the person who played the part that brought to the image, which I didn't know who that was going to be when I was, you know, thinking of it. But I also loved looking out and going out on my hunt for Vishnu. And, you know, because we're all hunting for our Vishnu. And, you know, I think that that's what I thought was very similar to the idea of the temple, is because, you know, you go some temples, and then that's where it comes down to the idea of the artistic rendering, right? You know, somebody's Vishnu is different than my Vishnu is different than, you know, so the Vishnu in North India, the Vishnu, I love the one, this one really did something for me. And, you know, everyone will have a different answer to that. So in that sense, that's where like the idea of a darshan gets really custom. So if darshan as a word itself is so subjective and custom, then how can my God not be, you know? So Yeah.
It, watching the individual selling the hair,
yes,
it hit me that I was also watching someone doing a religious ceremony.
Mm.
And it, I may be really off base here, but it seems to me that what I was actually watching in the video,
yeah,
was a larger religious ceremony going,
yeah,
on. This wasn't just about making art,
yeah,
but it was also somehow part of a worship service.
Yeah.
Am I off base in thinking
that? Yeah, but I mean, I think that that's what, like, my one medium of worship has become the camera, right? So in that sense, I'm sure his the one way that he can create or be one with his thoughts is through his sewing. And I feel like that's why I love the idea of people maybe doing yoga or playing a sitar in front of those photographs, because I'm thinking, wow, what, you know, the energy that they're transferring into the image. And, you know, it's all intent, right? That's what we talked last night with somebody. It's like, it's all about intention. Because so my dad tells me before I can trip the shutter that I should go up to these people who are playing the character and tell them to join me in honoring a greater legacy. Because up until that point, it's a fashion shoot. And but at that point, when you tell that person, this is all of us are together for something greater, it changes. Up until then, we were all doing our parts, you know, we were all creating our little pieces of the puzzle. And now, but it's all about to come together, but it can't happen without the person who's playing that part. And he really has to believe that he is Vishnu at that moment, or allow Vishnu to drive that picture. So I think I love the romance of, you know, even, and that's the reason why I love using film too, because, you know, you create a picture and then you can't see it. And then, you know, you drop it off at the lab, and then, you know, your life changes. People are born, people die, you change as a person. And then you go back and you look at that piece of film. And now the same thing that you created a week before, you're looking at from a completely altered perspective. And I think there was also where I also wanted to let go, because it was so micromanaging all the way up until the very end, that after doing all of that, I actually didn't want to see the image right away. I kind of wanted that distance from it, because I could make all of these 10 times over. You know, I can still notice, like, that one little corner that I could do something on, because that's just the nature of the creator. So you just have to back off at some point and say, I don't want to see this photo right now. So
for me, the analogy isn't so much with a religious ceremony, but it's actually with the kind of pre-production of a murti and setting up the temple space in Hindu temples already. Mm-hmm. And what you just said kind of, in a sense, confirms it, or sort of substantiates it, because, you know, there's the moment when in the murti is the statue.
Yeah.
And then there's the eye-opening ceremony, which is the part which it becomes an act of, you know, the presence,
yeah,
of the deity is called. So for me, the analogy was more with that.
Yeah.
However, my question, mm-hmm, is, you use the word humanization,
oh, yeah,
in response to this first interchange, which, mm-hmm, I think I was thinking about that throughout your whole talk and thinking about the work, because it is making representations of deities, mm-hmm, like intensifying the anthropomorphic element, like, mm-hmm, you know, so once the epics were filmed on film and it was humans playing them, they weren't carved representations, so there's, mm-hmm, been a sort of trend toward, yeah, making the Hindu deity images have become more and more closer to just regular human beings.
Yeah.
So I don't know what question exactly to ask about it, mm-hmm, it's just kind of what I've been thinking about and pondering, listening to you and seeing the images and thinking about the work.
Yeah.
So I'm just interested in hearing sort of your thoughts about that, participating,
yeah,
in that process, how intentional it is,
yeah,
what it means to you.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very intentional from the perspective that I love that ultimately it's the power of another human being looking back at me. So, you know, namaste is the God in me respects the God in you. And that is what namaste means. And so, but at the same time, you know, I've had comments where people are like, you know, but I don't want to run into Lakshmi at the subway. You know, there's something about not knowing who this deity that I'm worshiping is. And, but then you ask the sculptor, do you know the sculptor? Who did he do? Maybe he's like making you worship his mom, You know, he obviously had a reference because all of them are made in the image of, I mean, God has made man in his image. You know, and this is something that we are seeing in the renderings in Hinduism. This is what we are studying in other theologies, you know. So in that sense, I love that people are drawn to them. And then there's that play of, you know, oh, but this is a real person. Oh, but then I'm still drawn to them. But, you know, that's the part that is interesting, is that play of going back and forth between painting as photo, man as God, or just, you know, questioning the role of photography in all of this.
What has been your experience presenting this work to, like, a largely American audience?
Yeah. Oh, well, this is the least American audience. I mean, there is a lot of Americans in there.
Or as opposed to showing the work at home.
Yeah. It's been interesting. Actually, one of the places that I presented, there was a pilot from Air India who was in the audience, and he was like, "Well, this, you know, I think the biggest question that comes from the Indian audience is, well, what about using real people, you know?" And that's like the great that has been the dialogue that has been different than talking to American audience. And the questions from the American audience is often more process oriented, or, you know, but the Indian audience is more interested in, you know, just the role of photography, because, you know, a photo is proof positive. You know, that is how they didn't even make it into the galleries until the earlier 20th century. You know, a photograph is a means of keeping record. Like, that is the way we understand a picture. So here's a picture of Lord Vishnu, you know, so just that translation of, oh, but it's still the idea of image and memory, and through that the photo becomes something else. The photo is really just, the photo or the sculpture or the painting or the illustration are all a means to an end. Like through this visual, the hope is that you connect to something beyond. So why can't we make the photo do the same thing? You know, because they're all just mediums. If a stone can do it, then a photo can do it.
As disruptive as using humans was to the more conservative elements,
yeah.
Do you have any plans to do something even more disruptive than the deity?
I don't know. I'm scared. What are you about to suggest?
Well, I mean, you know, I loved the exhibit. Mm. And then there was like, okay, wow, there are human beings. Mm-hmm. That's a human form.
Yeah.
And it's like, for me, it's like, and this is just personality. Mm-hmm. How much further can we take it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Switching genders.
Yeah.
You know, making them more contemporary.
Yeah.
I don't know how that would be done.
Yeah.
But like in the West, you know, contemporizing Jesus and mm-hmm. Mary's been really hard.
Yeah. Yeah, it's been really hard. I think that is a really interesting thing with what Bridget has done in this exhibit, because you see this really, like, this legacy artist and, you know, the way he did it. And then, you know, what I've done photographically, and then I'm blown away with what Abhishek has done, where he's just taken Ganesha and he's given him these guns. And, you know, Ganesha is kind of a mix of Ganesha and a war hero and Avatar and Shiva. And, you know, so he's starting to really blur the lines. And it's very inspirational to see that. But I definitely, from the point that I started the project, for me, it was never going to be like this reimagining the archetype. You know, it was going to be working with it and bringing a new medium to it. But, you know, certainly, you know, the mind wanders and, you know, you want to push things. And I promise I'll keep pushing. Is that? I don't know where I'll push, though. Yeah.
So two questions. What camera do you use?
Yes.
And second is, yeah. What's Kali's day job?
What is Kali's what?
Day job.
Day job. She's a painter. So Kali's a painter. So she actually was like very involved. You know, she was like, oh, this is great. She's like, maybe if you could exaggerate. She was definitely kind of, you know, driving the painter crazy a little bit. So the story about Kali is incredible. And that's because I was really looking for a very long time for my Kali. And then she walked in and she had, you know, she's Bengali. So she had the perfect, you know, apple face for what I was looking for. And so she starts to, I'm taking a picture of her. And then she suddenly, my dad walks out and she says, "Sunil uncle." And, you know, she knew my dad from photos that her dad had shown her. And so my dad and her dad went to school together. But the funny thing is, my dad has told me stories of her family having the grandest Kali Pujas growing up. Like, he has been to their home to celebrate Kali. So Kali was a very important figure to this character herself. And I got to learn actually a lot about Kali from a very, you know, personal perspective from her. So those things, I feel like I couldn't have willed those things if I tried. You know, those things just magically happened. Like, I definitely didn't expect my priest to say yes to, you know, play that part. I didn't expect to find an architect for Brahma. You know, like, those things I think were just perks of the job. Camera. It's a 4x5 large format camera. And it's a Sinar. It's like usually actually a studio camera. It's for precision. It uses the bellows, and I don't know how much you know about it, but yeah.
The frames are really beautiful. I was just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
Yeah. So the frames were challenging because I wanted to use the frames as almost becoming kind of like a portal into another world, because they would be unnatural. So the frames are typically frames. They're usually used for doorways of temples. So not the temple that you walk in, not the doorway but that you walk into, but after you go inside, there is the little pulpit inside which the priest worships the deity. That entranceway is often made of hammered brass. So I had seen that in a temple in the Lower East Side, believe it or not. Like, there's a great temple in the Lower East Side. You know, what isn't in the Lower East Side, but there's a great temple. It's called the Broome Street Temple. And I went there, and actually the practicing yoga teacher there is Eddie Stern, who is, I don't know how many people here are real ardent yoga people, but he is a legendary yoga instructor. And he had the contact of the person who made the frame. He gave it to me. It was somebody down in Mysore. I spoke to them, and then they constructed a prototype for me. They sent me a piece. It was perfect. And then I had them basically make really, really thin facades, just the fronts. And then the rest of it came together in Bushwick, where all frames, all great frames in Brooklyn come together, because there's a lot of workshops there. So I actually worked with a carpenter who got the big blocks constructed and leafed in Brooklyn. And then we took the facades and then applied them onto the front so we could have depth.
They look like a temple.
What is your next project that you may have planned? Is it similar to the one that we have here, or is it different?
I feel like it's so boring to hear somebody describe a photograph. It's the worst thing. I was just reading. Somebody asked Robert Frost to describe the meaning of a poem that he wrote, and he said, "You want me to say it worse?" So I feel like I really shouldn't describe the picture, but it's definitely still rooted in the two cultures and the transformation. And that's all I can say.
Luckily for all of the rest of us who are not living in Brooklyn, Manjari is very active on social media. So at Manji, M-A-N-J-E-E, for both Twitter and Instagram. And for Vahishta, for Instagram might be most important because you have the best shot of seeing some previews. Mm-hmm. So please do follow her on both. She'll linger for a couple of moments if you have another question you might like to ask privately, but please join me again in giving her a final round of applause.